Belfast, after 12 years of what the Irish call the Troubles. In Northern Ireland, there are two communities with different loyalties. Protestants largely give their allegiance to the United Kingdom. Most Catholics feel that Northern Ireland should be part of a united Ireland. Today, the British Army patrols the province to hold apart the warring extremists of both communities, the result of a long history of conflict and political failure. Fifteen years ago, scenes like these were unimaginable. At that time, the Protestant Unionist Party had been in power for 40 years. The Protestant ascendancy seemed assured. The state appeared secure. But the events that would bring British troops back to Ireland again were imminent. The current phase of the Troubles was about to begin. It would take the form of a Catholic rebellion. July 1966. Queen Elizabeth II visits Northern Ireland. The Protestant majority greet their British monarch. Their loyalty expresses not only a desire to be British, but also a fear that they might be forced to be part of a united Catholic Ireland, which would threaten their Protestant way of life. So the Queen's visit was important and reassuring. Speaking to fellow Orangemen, Northern Ireland's Prime Minister, Captain Terence O'Neill, voiced loyalist feelings.
Alone, we would be a small, insignificant body of people lost in the Atlantic and surrounded by enemies. Many Ulstermen have fought in two wars to keep the flag of freedom flying around the world. Here in Ulster, the Union Jack is the flag of freedom. And my task, my duty, my resolve are to keep it hoisted at the top of the mast here in our beloved Ulster.
July is the month when the summer marches of the Protestant Orange Order celebrate decisive victories over Catholics of the 17th century. Catholics watch and resent these demonstrations of Protestant supremacy. A supremacy that was built into the fabric of the state. The police in Northern Ireland were armed and overwhelmingly Protestant.
Open the house!
They could call upon the services of the entirely Protestant police reservists, the B Specials. Behind them was the Special Powers Act, which empowered the Home Affairs Minister at the stroke of a pen to suspend all normal civil liberties. The fear was the Irish Republican Army, which had on occasions over the years resorted to force in its campaign against the Protestant state. But the IRA seemed no longer to be a threat. Now the province faced different problems.
Three, nine,
Shipbuilding and the linen industry were depressed. Unemployment was high. The economy needed radically reshaping. In that context, it made economic good sense to cooperate with the Dublin government. But Protestants were alarmed when O'Neill invited Sean Lamass, the Irish Prime Minister, to Belfast in 1965. For over 40 years, the South, devoutly Catholic, had been hostile to the North. Its constitution not only laid claim to sovereignty over the North, but also enshrined Catholic theology. Fears grew when the General Assembly of the Presbyterian Church met in Belfast in June 1966 to discuss closer ties with other churches. Some Ulster Protestants, particularly the fundamentalist Free Presbyterian Church, saw in these talks the danger of a Romeward trend and the erosion of Protestant values. Their leader, the Reverend Ian Paisley, had said that he hated God's enemies with a perfect hate. When their procession passed through a Roman Catholic district, Crummock Square, fighting broke out. Paisley was later charged with illegal assembly. '66 was a year of anniversaries. Fifty years before, thousands of Ulster men had been slaughtered at the Battle of the Somme. Protestants remember that sacrifice for Britain. But 1916 had seen another great event in Irish history, remembered by Catholics. The Easter Rising in Dublin, which had set the South on the road to independence. Sectarian tension mounted. Then Protestant paramilitaries killed two Catholics. O'Neill grew apprehensive.
In my opinion, brethren, the one way to endanger our constitution is by violence, by abuse, and by the gun. We live, ladies and gentlemen, in a changing world, and we must defend our constitution and our Ulster heritage in a modern way. Nor is it necessary to do this kind of thing in order to be a true loyalist.
To show that this country is not a democratic country, but this country has been run by a group of dictators from Glengall Street.
Glengall Street housed the headquarters of O'Neill's Unionist Party.
And for years, these men have tried to tell the Protestants of Ulster that they're loyal and they're true blues, but we have found them out now. They've been found out. The hidden things of darkness are being exposed in the light and in the focus of truth. God be with you till we
Paisley was about to go to jail, having refused to be bound over for his part in the Crummock Square riot. But there was also disquiet about O'Neill in the inner councils of the Unionist Party.
Prime Minister, would you care to comment on the meeting, sir?
No, very, very happy meeting, very successful. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
Any criticism at all, Prime Minister?
No.
O'Neill was finding Northern Ireland unreceptive to economic and social reform. The Unionist chief whip was James Chichester Clark.
Well, I think there's a certain feeling that perhaps the Unionist Party have gone soft on firm Unionist principles. Nothing could be further from the truth, but these are based on good many misconceptions that are being spread. They're based on things like the Easter Rising, the mass meeting, perhaps the ecumenical movement, all of which, although not directly, or many of which not directly affecting the government, are sometimes tied around the government's neck.
Now, when Protestants marched, they were worried by what O'Neill's liberal attitudes might unleash. Ian Paisley articulated their fears.
I'm a free-born Protestant, and all the intimidation, and all the slander, and all the lying about me will not stop me in my campaign in Ulster to keep Ulster out of the south of Ireland.
But O'Neill was not only faced by disaffected loyalist Protestants. Roman Catholics in Northern Ireland were disadvantaged. They were more likely to be unemployed, more likely to be in menial jobs, less likely to be rehoused. Positions of authority were largely held by Protestants. Not everyone in Northern Ireland had a vote in local elections, and local government had been manipulated so as to keep Catholics out of power. In Londonderry, two-thirds of the population were Catholic, yet there was a Protestant Unionist Council. In the 1960s, radicals, mainly Catholics, began to press for electoral reform and anti-discrimination in jobs and housing, and the abolition of the B Specials and the Special Powers Act. In Caledon, County Tyrone, a badly housed Catholic family was squatted in a house and evicted in front of television cameras. The house had been allocated by the Unionist Council to a young, single Protestant woman. A Catholic nationalist MP who had organized the squat spoke to Ulster Television.
Well, I've drawn attention, I might say, highlighted the situation. It's a form of non-violent protest, of which I felt was necessary, considering that I'd used every parliamentary strategy possible to remedy this injustice. And I give no assurance that in the future that I will not resort to similar activities in order to highlight the position.
Discrimination against Catholics had been dramatized. Marches demanding equal treatment, civil rights, were to follow.
Ladies and gentlemen, I would certainly hope that in conducting this march in our city, that we will act in a responsible manner, demonstrating to the authorities that our intentions are to secure civil rights for the people of our cities and not to cause strife or bloodshed in our city. We are demanding homes, employment, freedom of speech, and freedom of assembly. We do not wish bloodshed or violence.
The march through the predominantly Catholic city of Derry was not allowed into the Protestant centre. The march was poorly marshalled, and amid confusion, police battened the crowd. Belfast, a month later. Among other demonstrations organized in response to events in Derry, Belfast students, mostly Catholic, were marching to the city hall. Along their route was a loyalist counter-demonstration. The police stopped the civil rights march to avoid a confrontation.
Of the city desecrated by Republicans. Those that have cursed our flag have cursed our queen and our art to destroy our country. And I want to say that we are determined as ever to resist the Republicans from Queen's University.
The students responded with a sit-down protest.
I know, please.
The law in Northern Ireland will be maintained in the interest of all. We cannot and will not allow it to be flouted, nor will we permit others to take it into their own hands. It must now be evident that in the present atmosphere, further civil disorder carries the gravest risks, not for any one section of our population, but for all. No cause other than the cause of anarchy will be served by further riot and commotion in our streets.
O'Neill later made concessions to the civil rights movement. This further disturbed Protestants. O'Neill was becoming isolated. But for Catholics, it was too little, too late.
I want to tell the Ulster Cabinet that this great civil rights cause, which has grown in our country, is going to continue until such times as every town, every village has fundamental civil rights, until houses are allocated on the basis of merit and not on the basis of favor, until such times as every man, irrespective of his creed or his class, will be granted a job, until such time as all the people over the age of 21 will be entitled to vote in every election in our country in a democratic country.
Mr. Prime Minister, what was the biggest achievement of tonight's meeting?
No comment.
O'Neill survived another vote of no confidence. It was proving difficult to hold a moderate middle ground. The marchers intended to go through Protestant areas. In a country where both Protestant and Catholic are acutely aware of their territory, this was a defiant act. The march was blocked by Paisleyite demonstrators, harassed by Protestant vigilantes, and continually rerouted by the police.
We've had some difficulties along the route, and there are certain times we've been prevented from going through. We don't like that, but we feel that that demonstrates the fact that in Northern Ireland we have a situation like the southern states of America, where you do not have the basic democratic liberty of free procession.
We are not afraid. We are not afraid.
On the fourth day, the march was stopped near Derry. The marchers were told that there were Protestants armed with homemade weapons ahead. District Inspector Hood warned them that they might be stoned, but did not suggest that the march should be rerouted. After some discussion, it was agreed that the police would escort the marchers over Burntollet Bridge.
Police have said they are quite prepared to get us through
this obstacle. And if we all keep in very close formation on the right-hand side of the rope, the people throwing the stones will be on high ground on the right-hand side. If we keep in close formation on the right-hand side under the hedge, keeping well into the right-hand half of the road, then we should be okay.
The marchers walked into a carefully prepared trap. Loyalists were waiting on the hillside above the road. Many of the attackers were off-duty B specials, the reserve police force. Police protection had been inadequate, but when the marchers arrived in Derry, they were given a rapturous welcome. The march had polarized the two communities and had further undermined the authority of moderates in Northern Ireland. That night, the police went into the Catholic district of Derry, the Bogside, and to quote a government report, were guilty of assault and battery, malicious damage, and the use of provocative sectarian and political slogans. Northern Ireland was at the point of no return. The 11th of January, 1969. This civil rights march was scheduled to pass through the centre of Newry.
Last night, the local committee, on your behalf, made a decision. That decision was that they would not accept any reroute on this march. They would not accept this unjust and tyrannical ban imposed by the discredited unionist government. It is our view that we cannot go forward and accept any reroutes.
The parade will not be permitted to turn left at this point.
Your nonsense!
Order! I would now appeal to you all to be sensible in this matter and to continue a peaceful parade along the route which has been laid down.
The civil rights movement up to now has followed a policy of non-violence. Now, are we going to let down the decent people of this country?
No!
There are a lot of people have suffered.
Now, is their suffering going to be in vain? Or can we wait for a few more months to get the reforms which must inevitably come?
We fight them. We fight them. Come on. Come on. Come on.
As the stewards lost control, Catholic demonstrators were, for the first time, violent.
But I have also said that if there should arise a crisis in this land, when I would be needed to enter the political arena, I would not fear, but I would go with the support of the Protestant people. I am making a solemn declaration to you that if there is an election in the near future in Ulster, whether in prison or out of prison, I'm going to fight O'Neill and Vance!
Paisley was now emerging as a major Protestant politician. In February 1969, Protestant demonstrators in Belfast were chanting, "O'Neill must go."
O'Neill must go! O'Neill must go! O'Neill must go! O'Neill must go!
Then in March and April, there were bomb attacks against water and electricity installations. It was assumed to be the responsibility of the IRA. Actually, they'd been perpetrated by Protestant extremists. However, these incidents raised old fears and anxieties about the IRA. As water was taken from standpipes, O'Neill was blamed for the degenerating situation and the rebirth of the IRA. On the 28th of April, 1969, he resigned.
What is now impossible for me, maybe, I do not know, easier for someone else. But I have no regrets for 6 years in which I have tried to break the chains of ancient hatred. I have been unable to realize during my period of office all that I had sought to achieve. Whether now it can be achieved in my lifetime, I do not know.
The Unionist Party meets to elect a new leader who would automatically become Prime Minister.
Gentlemen, as Chief Whip of the Unionist Party...
There were two candidates, James Chichester Clark, thought to be more moderate than his rival, Brian Faulkner.
Major J.D. Chichester Clark, 17 votes. Mr. Brian Faulkner, 16.
Chichester Clark was related to O'Neill. British politicians at Westminster were following events in the province with increasing concern. Traditional Protestant summer marches were likely to spark off trouble. Chichester Clark would be urged by James Callaghan, Home Secretary and responsible for Northern Ireland, to ban all marches.
Banning these marches, which seem to cause so much trouble in Northern Ireland?
One judges each occasion on its merits and tries to act sensibly and with discretion and responsibility as the situation arises.
The Apprentice Boys' March, celebrating the relief of the Siege of Londonderry in 1689, went ahead. To have banned it would have put Chichester Clark's political career in jeopardy. Fifteen 15,000 Protestants marched that day in a city of only 50,000 people, the majority Catholic. In the Catholic bogside, barricades were built. Over the past 8 months, the police had twice attacked the area, damaging property as they harassed and taunted the residents. The pomp and strut of the march was met with Catholic jibes. Seven 700 police stood by. During the afternoon, Catholic youth stoned the march as it passed the bogside. The predictable disorder had begun. To no avail, moderates on both sides tried to defuse the situation. Yeah! As both sides threw stones, the police stood with their backs to the Protestant rioters.
Move back, please.
I belong to Jerry and I know that, friend. I know that. At the same time, these men here have to keep their backs to you and watch them. You're not helping.
So it appealed to you to go way back.
The police feared that if the Catholics broke out of the bogside, they would attack Protestant areas. The Catholics were afraid of what the police might do if they got into the bogside.
It is perfectly obvious that this country under the present constitution is ungovernable. You have civilians living in this area who are forced to barricade the place and to launch an almost military offensive on the police force of this country. Not because the people in this area want to break the law, but because they know that if they do not keep the police out of this area, that the police will come in here and ruin their homes and attack their wives and children. Therefore, since the police force are the people who are in fact disturbing the peace, there can be no confidence in the machinery of government.
In the early evening, the police tried to break through the barricades into the bogside. What had begun as an incident between police and a handful of youths had become a pitched battle. By nightfall, it was stalemate. Petrol bombs from Catholic youth were being answered by CS gas from the police. It was the first time CS gas had been used in the United Kingdom. On the evening of the second day, Chichester Clark went on television.
The irresponsible should know this. The law must and will be maintained. We have already said that we will not shrink from any necessary measure, however firm or however unpalatable. To that end, we are now acting to strengthen the hand of the forces of law and order. We will also use the special constabulary to the full, not for riot or crowd control, but to relieve the regular police of other duties.
The mobilization of the 8,500 B specials inflamed the Catholic population.
Somebody tries to throw that, the talk will come out and the petrol will go all over his back. That's why we've had people pouring down there. So get the cork in very, very tight, as tight as you can.
The local dairies later reported the loss of 43,000 milk bottles. That afternoon, with the RUC exhausted, Chichester Clark asked for troops to be sent in. In London, the Home Office had already decided their use was inevitable. As night fell, sympathetic rioting broke out across the province. Northern Ireland was on the verge of civil war. Now the focus of events shifted to Belfast. Here the situation was particularly grave. Police failed to control Protestant mobs. In the morning, Belfast Catholics were filmed abandoning their homes. That night had left 8 people dead. Eventually, 1,500 Catholic families and 315 Protestant families left their homes. On the morning of the 15th of August, 1969, British troops had marched into the streets of Belfast. Civil war had been averted by the intervention of the British Army. It was with considerable reluctance, and only to prevent great loss of life and damage to property, that the British government put its troops onto the streets. In the eerie calm that now descended on the province, both politicians and soldiers knew that it was going to be easier to send the troops in than get them out. Now the British government and its army were inextricably caught up in Northern Ireland and its future. The people of Belfast, particularly the Catholics, welcomed the army. They had brought an end to the burnings and killings. But armies are not constabularies, and soldiers are not policemen, nor are they a substitute for cogent political policies. No one knew this better than the army.
Thank you, dear. Thank you very much. Two, please, dear.
The honeymoon period cannot, I do not think, continue forever, obviously. We're perhaps at the peak now, where everybody's smiling and swapping cups of tea and all this sort of business and cracking jokes. But unless there is a solution or some hope for the future, and this is where the politicians have got to come in, the soldiers are not going to be welcomed on the streets for forever and ever.
The Home Secretary, James Callaghan, visited the troubled province on the 27th of August, 1969. For 45 years, British politicians had ignored Northern Ireland. It was the business of a Home Office department, which also regulated London taxi cabs in British summertime. No senior civil servant in Whitehall had worked full-time on Northern Ireland.
Well, you must have got thousands of pictures of us by now. We're not as handsome as all that. If we were Richard Burton and Elizabeth Taylor, come on.
In Derry's Bogside, Callaghan was greeted by enthusiastic crowds. John Hume, a moderate Catholic politician, also welcomed him.
On behalf of the people who are, in my view, the living criminals of injustice in Northern Ireland, I welcome you here because you will find in this area the worst housing and the worst, the highest unemployment and the heaviest emigration, and I hope you're bringing the solution with you.
Sir, this is Mr. Cooper to you.
I'm very glad to come. Very glad indeed to be here and to see everybody, and I want to be able to see everybody.
Please stand back, please.
Already the British government had announced that the B specials would be phased out, and Callaghan's civil servants were reviewing discrimination in housing and jobs. Caught in the crowd, he was forced to address the Bogsiders from an upstairs window.
I was told yesterday that I was welcome because I am neutral. I replied, I am not neutral. I am on the side of those, whoever they may be, and in whatever community they live, who are deprived of justice and of freedom.
In Belfast, the army would soon be confronted with the complexity of Ulster street politics. In the August fighting, both Protestants and Catholics had protected their districts by building barricades. The politicians ordered the army to pull them down and erect an official barrier, a peace line to keep the two communities apart. Both sides were suspicious, but they reluctantly agreed. Leader of the Protestant Shankill Defence Association, John McCaig,
The idea is here, take this barricade down now, and we'll conform with the government's plan that we give them time to get their plans implemented into the other side. Now, if they don't take action into the bog side and into the Falls Road area of Belfast, this and the Short Strand, these barricades will go up higher on Monday morning.
Meanwhile, across the city, the army was having difficulty in Dover Street, one half of which was Catholic, the other Protestant.
We've had a hold up for some reason, they've just seen about it now.
Hey, yeah. He wants you.
Yes. Who's saying hold?
General Freeland saw for himself the subtleties of the sectarian geography of Belfast.
Was it materials or
nice, so we've
got exactly where to put it?
Exactly where to put it, yes,
sir. Can I speak? Can I speak?
Of course you can, everybody.
Well, speaks. We live in Beverly Street.
Oh, yeah.
This is Beverly Street down yeah. here. What's you putting a barrier here for?
Well, that street is either. Yeah,
and us land, yeah. Yes.
Yeah, we could be down the street. I think we better leave it to whoever's arranging it.
Exactly. Yes. Well, wait to see about it.
There's a window city hall to see about it. Oh, have they? They've gone
there.
Yeah,
oh,
yeah.
That's me, right. Clark.
We want the time and everybody to agree where to put it.
Yes, but this was arranged in the city hall, sir, yeah. Where the barrier was going.
Was it?
Between the councillors.
Well, they're the people who've got to say where to put it, because we don't know.
Yes, they have already said where to put it, and that is the wrong place.
I see.
And I have tried to tell them all the morning.
Oh, I see. Well, they probably don't quite know. We'll sort it out.
The main reason being for the barricades to be negotiated were that some of them were facing sniper's fire. And the one down there, and this one at the very top, were the ones that were facing the sniper's fire. And they were to be negotiated to be put, not necessarily to be taken down. Well, we didn't get that privilege of even speaking to you.
Soldiers decided they can come down. Not up to me. I'm here to see what goes down fairly and squarely, okay, without trouble.
Only if the army was seen to be fair in a climate of political progress would it continue to be regarded as impartial. However, no major political initiative was taken. The use of the B-specials, the Protestant Police Reserve, had inflamed the rioting of the summer. Now they were obliged to surrender the arms they'd kept at home to a central armory. This worried Protestants, who regarded the B-specials as their protectors against militant Republicans. Paisley voiced Protestant fears.
The government will find that they will not be able to jackboot the Protestants any longer into the ground. I'm warning them that if they continue this policy of selling out Protestants and of trampling on Protestants and denying Protestants their rights, there's going to be an affair in Ulster that all the screaming voice that I might raise will no longer be heeded to.
On the day after a government report had recommended the abolition of the B specials, Protestants rioted in the Shankill Road and confronted the army. That night, snipers opened fire, and the army returned it.
The rules are extremely clear, and every soldier knows this, too, that if a person is shooting at us and our lives are in danger, and we can identify the person who's actually shooting at us, then we may return that fire with one round, and we shoot to kill.
Three men, two civilians and a police constable, were shot dead. 66 people were injured. The following night, the army drove into the Shankill Road and searched the area for arms. hostile Protestant crowd shouted, "Englishmen, go home. We want the B specials." They felt betrayed by the Westminster government. The next few months were relatively quiet, but as the army patrolled the winter streets, resentment began to grow in the Catholic ghettos across the city. A series of armed searches began this process of disaffection with the army. The IRA, dormant since 1962, was reorganizing. A split in the movement led to the emergence of the Provisional IRA, committed to the use of force.
You will be obliged to use no gas.
A Protestant march had provoked a riot in the Catholic estate of Ballymurphy. This time it was the British Army who held the Catholics at bay. Catholics now began to see the army as shoring up the system that oppressed them. The Provisional's bombs were directed at commercial targets in the centres of Belfast and Derry. By forcing the army to protect the city centres, they hoped to deflect them from the Catholic ghettos where the Provisional organisation was developing. Protestants were incensed by the campaign, since their businesses were its main target. By the end of June, there had been 54 bomb explosions, not all of them the responsibility of the Provisionals. No one had been killed. June 1970. Despite army advice, Chichester Clark again allowed the round of summer marches. This one, commemorating the Protestant sacrifice for Britain at the Battle of the Somme, passed by Catholic areas. Rioting was inevitable. Disorder spread across the city. After this film was taken, in the tiny Catholic enclave of Short Strand, surrounded by Protestant East Belfast, the Provisional IRA used guns for the first time to defend one of its districts. In the middle of these disturbances, the worst for a year, Reginald Maudling, Home Secretary, arrived in Belfast.
First of all, I think there is an impression in some quarters that the change of government in Westminster would mean a change of policy towards Northern Ireland. This, I may assure you, is not so. There is no change of policy towards Northern Ireland. It's our intention to support the Northern Ireland government in the program which they have set in hand.
In fact, the Conservatives, who'd just been elected to office, embarked on a policy of coercion. Powers were taken that made a 6-month sentence mandatory for rioting, and the army was ordered to get tougher. Maudling clearly found the situation confusing and difficult. After all, as Home Secretary, he had other things on his mind. Armed searches were alienating the Catholic community. In the Lower Falls, a search which produced 100 guns involved extensive damage to Catholic property. A curfew had to be imposed to stop subsequent rioting. Bread and milk had not been freely allowed into the area during the curfew.
said on all the TV reports, BBC and ITV, that food and milk got into this area. If it got in, the people were not allowed out onto the street until 5 o'clock. So what good was food and bed? And I stood and I personally watched while a milk truck was turned away. And I stood with, I must have been about 50 mothers, wives, crying, begging to get in to see their family, and a truckload of Scottish troops come out past us, and one beside the driver made the finger sign at us while we were standing there. Our children had no food, trying to get in to see what had happened to our families.
And have you noticed,
it hasn't happened according to the papers tonight. It's all a big dream. All we hear is about the impartiality of the great British Army.
The Catholic community was outraged. Recruitment into the IRA sold.
Shoot up, please. Come on, shoot up.
Come on. Dear, my
punk fucking Roger.
Shoot up, please. Go home now. You only toss your instrument. Go home now, please.
Take it easy. Come on. Break it up.
The authorities faced the classical problem of guerrilla war. How to neutralize guerrilla armies without alienating the community from which they spring.
We're not trying to incite the situation at all, obviously. What I would like is to make sure that everybody, you know, doesn't crowd round and create a crowd, because we don't want any trouble tonight, obviously, all right?
36 hours we're taking milk.
You blackened punk bastards!
In the intervening 7 months, over 4,000 homes, mostly Catholic, had been searched for arms. This film was shot immediately after just such a search. Catholic women might vent their anger on the troops in the streets, but young Catholic men were engaging them in guerrilla war. The disaffection of the Catholic community was complete.
When they come again, and again when they come out.
With the Provisionals a potent force in Northern Ireland, there was a growing demand for stricter security measures. Outside Stormont, the Northern Ireland Parliament, Protestants demanded imprisonment without trial, internment of those suspected of being members of the Provisional IRA. Lord Carrington, British Minister of Defence, met Chichester Clark on Saturday, the 20th of March, 1971. In line with British government policy, he would commit only a few more troops to Northern Ireland and refuse to tighten security further. Chichester Clark, like O'Neill before him, had been unable to placate the Catholic community and was now unable to extract from the British sufficient to hold his cabinet together. At a cabinet meeting later that day, he resigned. Unionist politicians thought that the man capable of delivering a strong security policy was Brian Faulkner, who succeeded him a few days later.
The kernel of our immediate problems in Ulster is the law and order situation. Here, we don't need new principles. What we need are practical results on the ground. Practical results in the elimination of terrorism, in the elimination of sabotage, and in the ending of riots and disorder. The rule of law will operate in all parts of Northern Ireland, so that the security which goes with the rule of law can be enjoyed quite literally by all our citizens.
Along with his firm law and order policy, Faulkner made overtures to the new moderate Catholic Party, the SDLP. An accommodation seemed possible. Then the British Army shot dead two Catholics during a riot in Derry. The rioting intensified. The SDLP could no longer cooperate with Faulkner. Civil commotion continued. The provisional bombing campaign was escalating. 220 bombs resulted in 6 deaths in the first 6 months of 1971 alone, and provisional snipers were now shooting British soldiers. Faulkner determined to be firm. Of the bin lids gave warning of internment. In the army's first raid, 342 people had been picked up, none of them loyalists. At 11:15 that morning, Faulkner, Home Secretary as well as Prime Minister, held a press conference.
Every means has been tried to make terrorists amenable to the law. But the terrorist campaign continues at an unacceptable level. And I have had to conclude that the ordinary law cannot deal comprehensively or quickly enough with such ruthless viciousness. I have therefore decided, after weighing all the relevant considerations, including the views of the security authorities, and after consultation with Her Majesty's government in the United Kingdom last Thursday, to exercise, where necessary, the powers of detention and internment vested in me as Minister of Home Affairs.
There was a violent reaction by Catholics. Shops and factories were burnt. Riots in Derry, Newry, Strabane, Armagh, as well as Belfast, went on for 4 days and left 22 dead. In the Ardoyne district of Belfast, Protestants abandoned their homes before Catholic intimidation, burning them as they left to prevent Catholics occupying them. Over 200 houses were gutted as families fled. In the wake of these events, there were 7,000 refugees. It had been the worst spate of violence since 1969. Faulkner, needing to placate unionists, had to be seen to be firm. Internment had been under consideration for some time as an alternative to a full-scale military offensive against the provisionals. Its successful use in the late 50s convinced Faulkner that it would be effective. 1,500 people were interned. Two-thirds of them had been released by the end of the year.
Going to work? What'd you work?
In security terms, it was not successful. Many Republicans got wind of it and slipped away. The provisionals were able to give a press conference at a school in West Belfast 4 days after the army had swooped. Their claims that the leadership was intact were substantially true. Certainly key figures escaped arrest. Joe Cahill, leading provisional.
Up to the present, we have lost one brigade officer, one battalion officer, and the rest are volunteers, or as they say in the British Army, privates. We've lost two senior officers.
Where's that, in the whole of Belfast?
In Belfast, yeah.
The army, who had opposed internment on the grounds that they were not well enough informed to pick up the right people, put a brave face on it.
Well, I don't know that I go so far as to say completely beaten, but they've taken a tremendous knock. There are still gunmen around, but they appear to be much more disorganized than they were before and don't seem to have much leadership or pattern.
Again, punitive measures against the provisionals had resulted in massive Catholic alienation from the army and government. Stories, largely true, of physical and mental maltreatment of internees were rife in the Catholic community. Later, Britain was found guilty at the European Court of Human Rights of inhuman and degrading treatment. Catholic children stayed away from school as a huge rent and rate strike was organized in Catholic areas. Moderate Catholic politicians resorted to the traditional political protest in Ireland, rejecting the government by setting up at Dungiven an alternative assembly.
And the leader of that section of opinion, then Sir Edward Carson, said in Coleraine on the 21st of December 1912, "In the event of this proposed Parliament being thrust upon us, we solemnly and mutually pledge ourselves not to recognize its authority. I do not care twopence if it is treason or not. Today, we do not recognize the authority of the Stormont Parliament, and we do not care twopence whether it is treason or not."
Hey, boy, get back here! Come back here! Come on, Mike!
The provisionals answered internment with the bomb and the gun. Up to August, only 15 members of the security forces had been killed. Within 4 months of internment, 41 had died. In the same 4 months, 66 civilians were killed and 1,078 injured. Warnings were usually given, but some bombs were ill-timed, some warnings inadequate, some bombings unclaimed. The campaign was designed to inflict maximum damage on the commercial life of the province. The need to guard the city centres stretched the security forces. It also gave the provisionals a breathing space. One particularly devastating technique was the car bomb. A demonstration that internment had not defeated the provisionals. Media coverage of these spectacular explosions brought them wide attention.
It wasn't a bomb, but it was an ambush, because when the troops arrived, fire was opened up down the road. Man hurt there.
Wait. Over there, look, over there, over there.
Ambulance! Get the ambulance there! There
they are.
First aid kit!
And I want to tell them today that there are thousands and thousands and tens of thousands of loyalists just as good as a man of 1912 who, when the crunch comes... will show Mr. Lynch and his fellow travelers, the Humes and the Currys and the Devlins, male and female. Let it not go out from this meeting that we are an irresponsible bunch of hotheads. Let it go out that we are cool, cold, determined loyalists who will never surrender and who are prepared.
On a winter Saturday, civil rights activists marched along the seashore to McGilligan Camp near Derry, where many local internees were held. They were met firstly by the police, and then by the 1st Battalion of the Parachute Regiment. John Hume led the protest.
Could you tell me on what authority that you're holding us back here from walking on the sea?
This is a prohibited area. You're not allowed in a prohibited area, and I guess we must
under what law? Would you ask those men to stop wearing rubber bullets? Women, please.
They will not. They'll stop you, provided you keep away from the war and don't try to enter this prohibited area.
Under what law is it prohibited, or under what authority is it prohibited? Can you tell me?
They've been prohibited by the police and by the government.
Well, the police tell me that it's you that is in command here, not them.
I am police of military here, this is a military area. And an authority of the government is to be decreed a prohibited area.
Yeah, and are you proud of the way your men have treated this crowd today?
This crowd has tried to come in a prohibited area.
As a member
of parliament were trying to stop them.
And you shot them with rubber bullets and gas. The crowd was marching over there, the leaders were going to speak to you before we even got there. Open fire.
That's right.
Fire was open after it came through the wall.
No, it was not. Fire was open as the crowd was coming across the beach.
Hume, I'm not here to enter an argument with you.
No, I am. I'm not here either. But I wouldn't be very proud of the conduct of your men today. They're a crowd of people, and they're totally unarmed people, as you can see for yourself.
If you lead all people away, then we'll go away too.
Yeah, but we want to march in there. Why not? It doesn't belong to you. It doesn't belong to you. You can't play.
You're prohibited by your government.
Who's government?
The government of Northern Ireland.
Not our government. And that's why you're here, because it's not our government.
Demonstrations had been banned at the time of internment. But on Sunday, the 30th of January, several thousand people in Derry marched towards the city centre. Factions in the Catholic community united against internment under the banner of civil rights. The army and police decided not to stop the march for fear of violence, but to contain it within the bogside. At the junction of William Street and Rossville Street, the marchers passed the army barricades. A substantial number of marchers broke away from the march and turned towards the army barricade. Battle began. Then the crowds fell back before the CS gas. Units waited behind the army barricades, ready to launch an arrest operation. They were members of the 1st Battalion of the Parachute Regiment, known to be one of the toughest regiments serving in Northern Ireland. Just before 4 o'clock, they were ordered in. Most of the rioters had dispersed.
Stand back and let them go.
Shooting had begun when a soldier opened fire on an alleged nail bomber. In all, 108 rounds of live ammunition were fired by the army.
John, to the priest.
Sorry,
They just came in firing. There was no provocation whatsoever.
Firing what, rubber bullets?
No, it was lead bullets they fired. They seemed to fire in all directions. There's some rubber bullets, too. They didn't even seem to fire gas. It was completely outrageous, disgraceful. I don't know. They call themselves an army. It's utterly disgraceful,
Are you quite sure that nothing was fired at them first?
There was nothing fired at them, sir. I'm absolutely certain of that. I can speak of this without any difficulty whatsoever, because I was there. I was just standing at the flats when the Saracens moved in, first of all, and there was nothing fired at them. Positively nothing fired at them whatsoever. There weren't even stones fired at them. People ran in all directions when they opened fire. Most people had their backs to them when they opened fire at the time.
A short while ago, we filmed you leading the way with a white handkerchief.
Yes.
For a party who were carrying a boy who was dead or dying. Now, how was he shot?
That little boy was shot when he was running away. He was just a little bit behind me when he fell. I heard the shot. I looked around. I saw him dying.
You saw him?
Yes. And he was shot...
He was a young man, wasn't he?
He was a young boy, I would say, about 15, thereabouts.
He didn't have a weapon?
No, he had nothing. He was just a young boy of 15. He was running. I was running too.
Colonel, once the paratroopers went into the bogside, there seemed to have been a very large number of casualties.
Well, I suppose large, five is quite large in these circumstances. It's unfortunate. But when we got up there, past William Street, here where we're standing, and up towards Rossville Flats, we came under fire. We came under fire from the bottom of the flats, We were also petrol bombed, and some acid, in fact, was poured on us from the top of the flats.
Local people are saying that you used excessive force when you went in there.
Well, what is force? If you're being fired at, you return fire, and they know that perfectly well.
How many gunmen do you feel you've hit in the bogside?
Well, I'm told from my Quixit rep, you must understand it's a very Quixit rep, that three gunmen were hit. We have not got the weapons, but this is the usual thing. We saw people come forward. I'm not going to say that I saw weapons taken away, because I don't know yet. I have not spoken to the men on the ground, although I was forward when the shooting was going on.
You have no worries about this action?
None at all.
Thirteen Catholic men, seven in their teens, had been shot dead by the army. 13 more were wounded. What really happened that day remains contentious. A government inquiry concluded, none of the deceased or wounded is proved to have been shot whilst handling a firearm or bomb, but that there is a strong suspicion that some others had been firing weapons or handling bombs. The Londonderry coroner differed. The army ran amok that day, he said. It was sheer, unadulterated murder. Nearly all the dead were shot in the back. Responsibility for what is now known as Bloody Sunday still awaits the verdict of history, but its impact on politics in Northern Ireland was immediate. In the days that followed, British methods in Northern Ireland were questioned. In Dublin, angry crowds burnt down the British embassy. In America, influential politicians made distinctly hostile speeches. In England, too, there was grave concern. The government in London began to make a reappraisal. A reappraisal that would end in the suspension of the Northern Ireland Parliament that had run the affairs of the province for 50 years, and the introduction of direct rule from Westminster.